the greatest attender of all time. You never know your level of underachieving until you see what overachieving looks like. When you're a teenager, the best place to see this is at graduation, when the same name is announced over and over. And the valedictorian is Doug Wallace. And the most valuable player is Doug Wallace. And the most likely to succeed is Doug Wallace. Each time, everyone in the audience, especially Mr. and Mrs. Wallace, thinks, "Goddamn, that Doug, he's gonna make something of himself." This was my experience sitting at our swim team graduation banquet. Though there were other underachievers like myself in school, the kids on swim team were superstars. Some were getting full ride scholarships and going to places like Spelman College, the University of Maryland, even Harvard. Others were planning to train for the Olympics. There were so many overachievers around me, and they were getting up and receiving plaques, trophies, and awards too. Consistent applause. The hard work I'd seen them put in was paying off. But every dog has his day, and mine came when I finally got my award that night. It was the honor I deserved for best attendance. My mom had been so strict that she never let me miss a day of practice. I think it was called the Participant Award, and it wasn't even a trophy. It was a certificate. Everyone knew it was the lamest award of the night. When they called out Kevin Hart from the stage, there was a sympathetic smattering of applause. I stepped up to the podium and placed one hand on the microphone. Every other kid who'd spoken had written his speech on a piece of paper or an index card. Now I was on stage for the first time in my life with no paper, no index card, no preparation, and no clue what to say. "Hello, I'm Nancy's son," I began, "though a lot of y'all know me as the cheater." Quote. The room burst into laughter. Everyone there knew and had probably made fun of that photo on the pool building's wall of me adjusting my goggles. But I would like to say for the record tonight that I never cheated. Otherwise, how would it be possible for me to go to more swim practices than anyone else here, yet not get a single award for my swimming? I heard people laughing, clapping their hands, slapping their knees. Best participant. That's like getting an award for being the team's best. Kevin. It's not an accomplishment or a talent, it's something that my mom decided. She should be up here getting this award. Mom, come on up. I hope this was worth all those whoopings. It felt as if something unlocked in me. I'd known that I was the fun guy who helped people lighten up and feel good. But I'd never known it was possible to do the same thing outside of a conversation and light up a whole room. On some level, my smartassery on stage was also fueled by my disappointment in myself, and I was trying to make the best out of a bad thing. So I just kept going. I started doing an impression of Coach Ellis, then the other coaches, then the most loved swimmers on the team. Most of all, I made fun of myself for being on that team for nearly 10 years. And getting the most pathetic award of the night, which I said I knew for a fact they gave me out of pity. After all, if they really liked me, they wouldn't have cropped me out of all the team photos. The best and the brightest had free ride scholarships to the best universities I went on, and all I had was a damn best participant certificate. That's not even gonna get me a job at the Shell station. I looked at my mom. She was shaking her head in shame. Yet I kept going. For a full 15 minutes. I didn't know I was doing stand-up, but in retrospect, it was my first comedy set. And it killed. Even though I wasn't the star of the team, I was the star of the banquet. Afterward, people kept coming up to the table where I was sitting with my mom, saying, "Great speech, Aunt Nance, that boy's funny, and you got a real comedian on your hands." Only when I look back on this now does it seem significant. It was the only comedy show of mine that my mother ever attended. It actually was a good speech, she admitted when the ceremony ended. But I didn't feel good. I was walking out of a room full of winners with a goddamn perfect attendance certificate in my hands. That night felt like a farewell to my childhood. After nearly a decade, it was the end of swim team and the end of most of those friendships. I wouldn't be going to practice the next day or competing in a swim meet the next weekend. It was over. I used to resent being forced to spend so much time swimming, but when I was hugging people goodbye that night, I was practically crying. I didn't understand that what I'd done that night could be a career. I just thought I had made a funny speech that compensated for the fact that, unlike everyone else there, I was going nowhere in life. 24. Another day in the life of a hero. Graduating high school was one of the most schizophrenic days of my life. I'm fucking free. I danced through the hallways. Fuck school. Fuck swimming. Fuck everybody. Mom, kiss my ass, I ain't doing none of your shit. No more. But when I left that building for the last time, reality dawned on me again and I thought, wait a minute. Where do I go? I still don't have a plan. In the SATs. I should have tried. Hold on a minute, you're all going away. And you all got a plan. Every single one of you. I woke up the next day with nothing to do and nowhere to go. All the structure and control that I hated so much was gone. I had total freedom, and it was terrifying. It felt like a giant sinkhole had opened beneath me and I was falling in. Everything had been for free, and I'd taken it all for granted and blown it off. I spent the next few days lying around the house, watching television, hanging out with friends, and trying to think of a direction for my life. One afternoon, my mom came home from work and said that we needed to have a talk. It turned out there was a plan, but it was something I'd forgotten. My mom said she was going to keep her end of a bargain we made a few years ago. All I remembered about the deal was that when I turned 18, I would be free. But there was another piece to it. I'm not going to pay for you to live under my roof and come and go as you please and do nothing with your life, she lectured. Like I said, you're going to find a college. With her help, I registered for summer school at Community College of Philadelphia and picked my classes. Then I hastily put together a plan, get my scholastics together, take the SAT again, and go to Temple or another big college to play basketball. It felt like going backward, but it was a life lesson and a chance to start over. Then she delivered the worst news of all, I'd need to get a job too. There was only one job I was qualified for, lifeguarding. I went back to visit my swim team coaches, who had a list of the community pools in need of lifeguards. When they handed me the printout, there was only one pool on it. Belfield, which was more like a wet jail cell than a swimming pool. It wasn't much of a job, since I was only working 2 or 3 days a week. But it was just enough to keep my mom happy. On my first day of work, I saw what looked like half the neighborhood crammed into a tiny pool. It was more people than should reasonably be in a pool, and definitely more than a young, inexperienced lifeguard could control. On my second day, the pool was even more crowded, and I saw a little boy playing in the middle of everyone. He seemed excited, like he was having a good time in the midst of the chaos. As I sat there watching, one of the senior lifeguards jumped in the water, grabbed him, and brought him out onto the deck. I jumped off my chair and ran to him as the other lifeguard was turning him over. The boy was on his back now and coughing. I stood there stupidly, trying to figure out if he was breathing or if I needed to give him CPR. Then I realized that if he was coughing, he must be breathing. Heart, you didn't see that? The senior lifeguard shouted at me. Nope. No, I did not. I thought he was playing. I had no idea that he was serious. People, before you judge, you need to know that it's not always possible to tell the difference between someone who's playing and someone who's panicking. They're both usually yelling. They're both waving their hands. They're both splashing around. And if they're surrounded by 50 other kids who are also yelling and waving their hands, it's like some Where's Waldo shit. Except harder, because everyone's wearing swimsuits. My point is, if you're planning to drown, tell somebody first. My other point is, there were 50 motherfuckers standing around that kid, and they didn't notice either. My real point is, I got fired. The call the next morning went exactly like this, no need to come to work. We don't think it's safe for you to be here. By that they meant safe for me, not for the swimmers. Motherfuckers at that pool were mad. Fortunately, basketball tryouts were coming up at community college, and that was what I really cared about. Maybe my playing could make up for my poor academics and I could go from here to the Temple House to the 76ers or something. That struck me as a good plan. And it would be easy to shine because the community college didn't have a big team, they probably played like three other schools. So I showed up at tryouts, feeling overqualified. And I didn't make the team. I didn't make the fucking team. I didn't make this small-time community college basketball team. It had never occurred to me that when I stopped growing during school and everyone else kept growing, my basketball career was no longer on a growth trajectory either. My totally impractical and pretty vague but only plan for my life went up in smoke that day. Meanwhile, classes were going horribly. In math, the teacher handed out a pop quiz. I was in no way or shape prepared for it. I thought you just had to study for the regular tests. The quiz may have been his way of checking to see how much we already knew, but whatever the case, I failed it. Probably got the lowest score in the class. After I failed that test, didn't make the basketball team, and got fired from my first job, the terror really sank in. Up to that moment, I just made a mistake by not trying and not having a direction. Now I was putting in effort and planning for the future, and I still failed. This meant the problem wasn't my thinking, the problem was me. I wasn't good enough. And on top of everything, I'd been going through a 5-month dry spell. 25. Crossing the desert. Or is it the desert? I'll just put both in here, so I'm safe. I applied myself to the one thing I could succeed in that summer, taking advantage of my mom's more relaxed regime. My friend Spank had been inviting me to a club called Dancers, and finally, I was able to go with him. I'd known Spank since high school, because he used to play basketball in our neighborhood. He was another friend with a plan. He was attending Temple University, but he'd stop by the community college to meet me all the time. Because he thought the community college had a better male-to-female ratio. We started going to dances and trying to meet girls, if nothing worked out. We'd end up at a 24-hour McDonald's nearby. I spent a lot of nights at McDonald's. I was on a draw that felt like it would never end. No matter who I talked to in the club, she had no interest in me. It's one of the worst feelings in the world when you start to believe that the person you see in the mirror every day may not be attractive to anyone except your mama. I couldn't afford to buy the designer clothes other guys were wearing, so I didn't even have a fighting chance. The best I could muster was a baggy foot-stained sweater and baggier jeans, with dirt so deeply embedded in the denim that no detergent was strong enough to remove it. Spank, on the other hand, was a big guy with a booming voice, a colossal personality, and enough money to buy himself a guest denim jacket and matching jeans. He'd get on the dance floor, and women surrounded him. I'd try to dance my way in there, half swallowed up by my dirty clothes, and the next thing I knew, girls would be asking each other, "Y'all tired?" I had the desert dick of a lifetime. Until one night, I met someone who didn't excuse herself to go to the bathroom or run off to her friends after 20 seconds of talking to me. She was packed into a tight dress that showed off everything, but she was fun and loudmouthed like one of the guys. We laughed and snapped on each other the whole night until finally she said we should hang out. I'd been on such a losing streak that if she hadn't made the first move, I probably wouldn't have suggested it myself. "Where do you work?" I asked. "I'm in school." The next day, I ran into her at community college. We hung out in the cafeteria, laughing for hours. She was as witty as me, but much prettier. Soon, we were hanging out between classes, going to the movies, eating dessert at Dave and Buster's, and doing the corny shit you do when you're too scared to make a move because you don't want to lose the only female in your life with whom you have a chance. "How long you gonna be her best friend?" Spank would ask me. "I'm just taking it slow. I don't want to ruin it." "Well, you better hurry before you get so thirsty you die of dehydration." I was now in my third week of community college, and I just couldn't bring myself to crack open a textbook and care about these random subjects that had little to do with the real world. I felt like school and this way of learning. Cramming random knowledge into my head and then trying to retain it long enough to pass a test or two about it wasn't for me. Like most things I'd done in my life up to that point, I didn't think much about the decision that came next. Better to be happy, I figured, than successful or rich. The next day, I left the house with my book bag just like every other day. But instead of going to school, I went to a clothing shop called Net and filled out a job application. Then I applied to work at a Ross Dress for Less store. I didn't tell my mom about my change of heart. I couldn't bear to see the disappointment in her eyes. I had no work experience outside of those two disastrous days of lifeguarding. So I figured it would be a while before I got hired somewhere. But at my third stop, a city sports on Walnut Street, I got lucky. The manager was a woman named Brooke and she asked why I wanted to work there. I knew that the words I spoke didn't matter. She was judging something deeper, my personality, my values, my character. Like anyone in her position, she was looking for someone who'd make her job easier, someone who was committed to the work and not just going to disappear into school in the fall. So I poured on the charming manipulation. School isn't on the horizon for me, Brooke, I told her, with a laugh in my voice, but all the while thinking about how my mother would reach for the closest Hot Wheels track to whop me with if she heard that. So I'm looking for a job where I can be for a while. It worked, because she soon told me, with your personality, I think you'd be a good fit in the sneaker department here. Then she gave me a pamphlet. Memorize this, she instructed as I left. You have a week to study it and then you start training. You need to know these sneakers inside and out because our customers expect us to be experts. Yeah, yeah, I got it, thank you, thank you. You won't regret this. It was a miracle. Not only did I find a job quickly, but that store and the people there ended up changing my life. I might not be doing what I am today if I hadn't walked into that particular place on that particular street with the exact combination of people who worked there. I was on such a high that night, I finally ended the drought. I slept with the girl I'd met at dances. It was worth the wait. We'd spent so much time talking and getting to know each other that it wasn't just sex by that point. It felt like love, which was a scary thing. Her name was Tore. We would have an on and off, up and down, round and round relationship together for the next 12 years. And well before the end of the story, you're going to be scratching your head just like our friends and families did, wondering how, and more importantly, why we put up with each other for that long. That first love casts a spell that's hard to break. A few days after I was hired at City Sports, I broke the news to my mom. I knew her well enough to add just the right amount of optimism to the conversation. I told you, you're not gonna do nothing, she said predictably after I informed her that I was leaving community college. That enabled me to respond, I'm not doing nothing. I got a job. They hired me at City Sports. She hesitated, trying to figure out how to get me back into school, and I continued, I need more time to figure out what I really want to do, but in the meantime, I'll work. I watched her chew this over in the steel teeth of her mind until at last she spat out the one word I was hoping to hear, fine. 26. Warning, this chapter contains a word, so you may also need to be a genius to understand it. A week later, I reported for work. Did you study the pamphlet? Brooke asked. Once again, my aversion to studying had bitten me in the ass. Inside and out, I replied. That was true, I'd spent a lot of time studying the outside of it. Then put it inside a drawer. After a short on-the-job training period, I received my first test. I was on the floor and a customer was asking for a good running shoe. I had no fucking idea. I looked around and grabbed a nice looking sneaker. He seemed surprised. Really? That one? I committed. It gives you great forefront protection and ankle support. You're gonna get a lot of mileage out of this one. He picked it up and examined it. and it's built with thin silate for comfort, so it won't feel bulky on you. I had no idea what I was saying, but I kept going until, to my complete shock, he tried it on, thanked me, and bought a pair. After that, I was on a roll. The next customer played tennis. Oh, okay, I got something for you. These are some of my best tennis sneakers. I like them because they're more flexible for those short sprints. I just talked out of my ass and people bought it. At the end of the day, they were happy customers, and that's what it was all about. I didn't need to study that pamphlet. I didn't need to study anything again. I could bullshit and personality my way through all the footwear here. Personality, man, it'll save your life. After a few weeks of this, I started to think, damn, I'm actually pretty good at shoe sales. I could really shine in this space. Then I thought, how much better would I be if I actually took the time to learn about the sneakers, the verbiage, and how to speak the shoe talk. That night, I surprised myself by opening my drawer, pulling out the pamphlet, and studying it. 1 week later, sweetie, first of all, what do you do? Yeah, let me see your feet. Oh my god, amazing arches with normal pronation, you're lucky woman. And the good thing about that is you're protecting yourself from future shin splints. Let me get a shoe for you. It's got a nice Eva midsole for a softer run, plus a padded sock liner for extra comfort. With those beautiful feet of yours, it'll be like walking on air. I thought I had done well when I was making it up. But now that I was starting to understand the merchandise and learn the differences between supinate and overpronate, compression molding and injection molding, ethylene vinyl acetate, and polyurethane foam, I was unstoppable. It turned out that personality plus knowledge equaled success. The store paid us hourly and only gave us a commission after we surpassed a certain number of sales. When I finally got that first commission check, I was hooked. I kept asking for more hours at the store. I was willing to work as much as they were willing to let me and to cover anyone's shift. I wanted to see how big I could get those checks to grow. Thanks to my mom's training in keeping busy, working double shifts came naturally to me, even with the 40-minute commute each way. And this was better than all my past activities. Not only did I get a check for it, but the better I got at it, the more I was paid. It was instant gratification. One of my supervisors was a woman named Alice. She was in her late 20s with a close-cropped haircut like mine and always dressed casually in sweatpants, a t-shirt, and whatever new sneaker was out that season. She was the first out of the closet lesbian I'd known and one of the coolest people I'd ever met. During the quiet night shifts, we'd sit together and she'd break down the way the world worked. I'd listen eagerly as she told me, in her easygoing way, about rent and bills, politics and culture, and other things I'd never learned in school. She was also the first older woman I'd met who, like me, was a people person. She loved meeting everyone, and everyone loved meeting her. It wasn't an act either. She had an accept me for who I am or don't accept me at all personality. And I thought, you're so dope. The fact that this is who you are and you embrace it without tiptoeing around it, I love it. I realized through her that we move through life, especially in our first 25 years, as sponges, slowly soaking up information from different people, environments and experiences, and this becomes us. Some people fill up early and get stuck in their ways, and others keep absorbing their whole lives. From Alice, I soaked up the idea that I can be me and be loved regardless of what others may say or think. Not going to college, not taking the safe route, and not doing the by the book thing was tough. I doubted myself a lot, especially when I saw so many friends from high school and swim team moving into adulthood in a traditional way. But here was Alice. She hadn't gone to college or followed a traditional path either. Yet she'd become a store manager and was working her way up to the corporate level. She was smart, confident, and happy just as she was, and she never complained or envied anyone. She had her life together. I was in awe of her, and it helped me see that even though I was different from the high achievers on swim team, I could make something of myself as well. As the weeks continued to pass, the enjoyment I experienced from letting my personality shine in convincing people to buy sneakers intensified. City sports became my world. After work, I'd hang out with Alice, her girlfriend, a security guard named James, a manager named Jay, Jay's girlfriend, and half a dozen other store employees. They became a second family. Most of them were older than me, and I started to mature just through being with them and trying to keep up with their conversations. It was my first time in the adult world, and I was hearing about real problems with real consequences. My check for this week hasn't cleared yet, and I can't pay my bills. I hear you. I don't know if I'm going to be able to keep living in my place. The landlord is trying to evict me. Well, look, let me check my balance and see if I can help you, but then you gotta pay it back by the end of the month because I got a car payment to make. I just sat there listening, thinking, damn, I'm living at home with mom, using my paycheck to buy the latest pair of Jordans. I need to grow up. When I came home after work most nights, my mom would grill me like a police detective. She was sure I was on a street corner somewhere selling drugs. Otherwise, it didn't make sense to her that I was working so hard without any lectures or discipline from her. Eventually, she decided to come to City Sports and find out what was really going on. She walked through the entire store, examining everything. She watched me work and deal with customers. She even spoke with my co-workers. She would have made a great parole officer. When I got home that night, she barraged me with more questions. What are you getting paid? How much of that is commission? How often do you get a check? Are you looking to get promoted there or to work somewhere else? And then came the real question, the one behind them all, what are your plans for your life? I took a deep breath and told her that I was ready to take the next step. I want to save up enough money to find my own place. This way, you won't have to take care of me anymore. I waited for her reaction. She thought about it for a moment and then said approvingly, at least you're starting to think ahead. 27. All hail General Hart. There was a Nike rep who used to come by the store with the latest sneakers and apparel. He was sharp and his sales skills put me to shame. All I had was personality and entry-level knowledge, but he had the hookup, he had true expertise and authority, and he had a rare attribute that's hard to learn, taste. Whenever he came to the store, he made sure all our Nike products were placed and displayed to the company's liking. If they weren't, he'd rearrange them himself and explain why this way was better. Then he'd tell us about the products we were going to get in the next shipment, what was cool about each new item, and why we should be excited about them. I never knew that this could be a career, just traveling to different stores and representing cool shit. He had what seemed like a high-level position with a prestigious brand, and he was apparently trusted to hustle alone, without a manager or supervisor breathing down his neck. One night after his third visit to the store while I was there, I came home and told my mom, I got it figured out, I have a real plan now. I want to work for Nike, mom. I told her my dream to gain more knowledge about the sneaker business, climb the ladder at City Sports and then transition to Nike and become their rep. My mind was made up. That was my life goal. I started doing triple shifts whenever I could. I worked holidays, my birthday, all the time. It wasn't just about money anymore, I had a dream fueling me. Nothing mattered but work. I wanted to be employee of the month. I wanted to make manager. I wanted to go to corporate. I wanted to do whatever it took to get to Nike. I saw my future in front of me and was running to greet it with a nice Eva midsole and a padded sock liner to prevent shin splints. I became known as the guy in the store with all the energy. I learned where everything was in the storage room, and I'd leap down the stairs to get sneakers for someone to try on, then sprint back with their size before they knew what hit them. During the lunch rush, the manager loved having me on the floor because I'd be helping half a dozen customers at the same time. Soon, customers were stopping by the department just to see me. If they were having a tough time at work, I tried to lift them up and make their visit to the store a highlight of their day. I discovered that I had a talent for remembering faces and names. And by recognizing and acknowledging people, I started getting regulars. Hey, Ross, good to see you, man. Did your kids like them? Sneakers, Abby. You ready for a new pair of gym shoes, Mrs. Dali? However, even a people person doesn't like everyone. So I learned the flip side of customer service, meeting people who aren't so friendly, but still smiling and being cool with them. There were the grumpy middle-aged men who sent me up and down the stairs 12 times for different sneakers and sizes, then didn't buy anything. There were the careless teenagers who put on a pair of sneakers, walked all over the store with them, creased them up, and then left them scattered on the floor in another department. This taught me a level of patience that I hadn't yet learned. When my patience was stretched too thin, I'd go down to the storeroom and talk shit about customers with my co-workers. That motherfucker's had me running down here 15 times for sneakers. And he's not planning to buy nothing. Who? Green shirt. Yeah, green shirt. You know he does that all the time. I hate it when he comes in here. You know who's worse? Tortoise glasses. He back. Yeah, I'm not taking him. One of y'all take him. He gets me mad and I'll end up saying something I'll regret. One afternoon, Brandon, one of the managers, called me into his office. I didn't know if he was going to cuss me out for talking smack about customers or praise me for all the hard work I'd been doing. I wanted to talk to you, he began very earnestly, and say that your drive and work ethic are not going unseen around here. I breathed a visible sigh of relief. We see what you're doing and we really, really like it. And we want to give you a small raise and move you up a little bit on the chart. I couldn't believe it. I was climbing the ladder. We'd like to make your floor general and give you a 75-cent raise. I'll make you proud as floor general, sir. I was beyond excited. I was going places. I was successful out here in the real world, more successful than I'd ever been in classrooms and pools. I left his office and marched back to the sneaker section. Me, hey, guys, look, y'all know I'm the floor general now. Colleagues, what? Me, didn't they tell you guys? Yeah, they're gonna give me the shirt tomorrow. Colleagues, floor general. Me, y'all know what that means, so let's make sure all these displays are straightened up here. Colleagues, all right, they're straight, Kev. Me, good, good job. You guys are doing really nice work. I'll put that in my report. I had no idea what a floor general was. It was probably some bullshit title to motivate employees. For all I knew, they gave it to a different employee each month. But man, it had the word general in it and it sure felt good. When I started walking around in a shirt with FL General written on the back while everyone else had shirts that just said City Sports, it went straight to my head. As soon as a customer crossed the threshold of the department, I'd march right up and introduce myself. How you doing? I'm Kevin Hart. I'm the floor general here, you know. So if you need anything, come to me. If somebody else isn't taking care of you, I'll take care of you in the best way possible. I understood then why people who are given a title start acting high and mighty and think they're better than everyone who doesn't have that title. A title carries authority. A uniform carries authority. Even a security guard putting on a badge and utility belt and heavy flashlight starts to think, all right, they gotta listen to me at this mall, because I look like I'm in charge. Though I probably became insufferable for a little while, the authority also helped me grow. I wanted to live up to that title and the store's trust in me, and I became more professional and responsible than I'd ever been. I took the position so seriously that when my friend Spank visited me, I refused to give him an employee discount because it was against store regulations. He never returned. After I saved a few $100, I started looking for an apartment, but I couldn't afford both the deposit and the first month's rent. I knew a crazy motherfucker from my neighborhood named Zachary, who had originally introduced me to Spank. I always thought Zachary was bow-legged because he'd walk like he was squeezing a bowling ball between his thighs. One day, I asked him if he was born like that. Born with a big package, he responded. What? Yeah, it's like the male equivalent of a chick with her back arched and her tits thrust out. She wasn't born that way. She learned to walk that way to send a signal, know what I mean? You gotta be kidding me. Girls love this bow-legged shit. I asked if he wanted to get a place together, because living with him would be the opposite of living with my mom. However, Zachary and his big package were living with a girlfriend for free, so he introduced me to a buddy of his named Paul who was looking for a place. I convinced Paul that it would be a good idea to get an apartment together, and we found a two-bedroom spot above a barber shop. The rent was $400 a month, which we split. I'll never forget the address because it was my liberation, 22 Westmoreland Street. I no longer had to get permission from my mom or answer a million questions. When there was something I wanted to do, I could go wherever I wanted and stay out all night and answer to no one. Most importantly, I got my own room with a door I could close for privacy. Meanwhile, the fact that mom was all alone at home became more and more upsetting to my brother. He didn't like that she was on her own in a dangerous neighborhood, especially considering she'd already been robbed, even if that robber happened to be our dad. Listen, I didn't go to the military just to come home and end up going to jail, he told my mom when we were at the house visiting. If someone came in here and cooked and robbed you, fine. But people know you're alone now, and what if someone walks in here and knocks you upside your head? Then we're going to have a problem because I'm going to go find him and take care of him. But my mom refused to move. Eventually, my brother got fed up with her stubbornness and pulled me aside. Kenneth, look here, man. She's getting old. She don't know what's right for her anymore. This is what we're gonna do. We're going to go there when she's at work, and we're going to move all her shit to my house. I got an extra bed she can use. Me, so let me get this straight. You're upset that mom got robbed while she was at work. So while she's at work, you're going to come in and take her stuff and put it somewhere else. Kenneth, yeah, exactly. Me, so you're gonna rob her. Kenneth, no, man, that's not what I'm doing at all. Me, then what's the difference? Kenneth, I'm not stealing it. I'm moving it to my house. Me, so if I walk into someone's house while they're out, take their stuff and move it to my house, it's not stealing. Kenneth, never mind. Me, okay. Even though I was out of the house, I was still a mama's boy. I told her what Kenneth was up to, and she told him not to even think about it. What the fuck is wrong with you, man? My brother yelled at me. She's our mom. It should be her choice whether she moves or not. I didn't like the idea of my mom, who was so strong and independent, becoming a guest in my brother's place and dependent on him like that. It didn't seem right for her. I also didn't want to lose my childhood home and all the memories that were stuck in my head as firmly as the roaches on the duct tape by the sink. Eventually, Kenneth moved all mom's shit anyway, and she ended up living with him. She wasn't too happy about it. So I consoled her the best I could. Mom, this was all Kenneth's idea. Our family had changed again. I was independent, Kenneth was the man of the house, and mom was the kid. Growing up is a strange thing. 28. I was gonna call this one, my genius finally gets recognized, but hey. Chapter before last had the word genius in it, and there are only so many chapters you can name genius in a book. That's one of the many burdens of being a genius. I eventually became so comfortable at City Sports, I started letting all the strange parts of my personality loose. You get a lot of weird parts to your personality when you spend half your adolescence in an imaginary fort in an old lady's basement. I'd ask my coworkers, you want me to be a completely different character for the next two people? Sure, Kev, be Urkel or something. Okay, but y'all can't laugh. You gotta let me talk the way I'm talking and go the way I'm going. Don't even smile, cause that's gonna make me laugh. I'd sell shoes as different television characters or using a silly voice. When that got too easy, I'd try selling a Timberland boot to someone looking for running shoes, or we'd have contests to see how many times we could make a customer say what. Even at work, it was still about being the fun guy. One day, during the after-work rush, we were playing my favorite game. Slipping in cuss words without customers noticing. Alice was working that day. And Michelle, one of the oldest employees in the store, was keeping count. Me, you know, this is a great shoe, but I would say you need to probably go get a dick or something first. Customer, I'm sorry, what? Michelle quietly, in background, one. Me, I said this is a great shoe, because it's got a great polyurethane fuck sole. But you should try it on to make sure it farts first. Michelle, 2, 3. I won that round with 4 curses to a single customer. Then we got bored and played the what game. I really think this is a good shoe for you, I told a businessman, then started mumbling, and you know what, at the end of the day, you'll probably fall or something if you don't get them. Excuse me, I didn't catch that. I cursed under my breath because it didn't count if someone didn't actually say the word what. As the stream of customers thinned out and the end of the day approached, I was leaning on a countertop where we sold watches, heart rate monitors, and other electronics, recapping the highlights of the day with Alice and Michelle. We were all laughing about it so much that Alice was wiping tears out of her eyes. You're fucking hilarious. You should do stand-up comedy, she said. Really? You're probably one of the funniest guys I've ever seen come through here. Kevin, Michelle answered. She was even more enthusiastic. No one's even close. You should think about doing comedy for real as a second job. Where would I even do comedy at? There's a comedy club near here. I've been there. What do you gotta do there? People get on stage and they tell jokes. It's cool. You have to try it. That's when I said the word that changed my life, okay. It was as nonchalant as every other okay I'd uttered. I basically shoulder shrugged my way into comedy. You gonna do it for real? Alice asked. She couldn't believe I'd agreed so easily. Yeah, I'mma do it. I know you'll be good, Michelle said confidently. On the bus home that night, reality sank in. Who do I have to speak to so I can perform there? What if they say no? What the hell am I gonna talk about? How much time do they give me? How much does it pay? I basically became my mom. When I told my friends about it, their reaction was the exact opposite of everyone's at work. What? Zachary asked. You gonna do what, man? Stand-up comedy at this place near work. Why you gonna do that? I don't know about that, man. Spank wasn't any more encouraging. Those people at work don't know you, man. They think you're funny because you talk too much and you get silly with it. But on stage, that's gonna be pesty to people. They're gonna tell you just like we do, yo, shut up, Kev. Quote. Really? I'm playing with you, man, but really, you need more confidence before you try to go up on stage. Your friends may love you, but the problem is that they love you as you are. You play a role in their lives that they've gotten used to, so they don't always want you to change. Most of them think their job is to keep you humble and in your place. As for the person you're dating, he or she may support you or not. It depends on a few variables: how good the relationship is, how old the relationship is, how your last plan turned out, and whether this change will bring you closer to or further away from that person. Fortunately, my relationship with Tori was new, and I had a good track record with her, so she was supportive. I think you're funny. You can do this. Those few words meant a lot. I had never thought that being the fun guy could be a legitimate career. I was always being told to get serious about my life. Sure, I'd seen Eddie Murphy cracking people up, but he was Eddie Murphy. I was Kevin Hart, a sneaker salesman struggling to pay the rent and hoping one day to get hired by Nike. The next day, Alice and Michelle told the other employees that I was going to try stand-up comedy, and they all came up to tell me I'd be great. Their confidence was probably what ended up motivating me to go through with the idea. I called the comedy club, the Laugh House, and asked if they had spots for new comedians. The woman who answered said they had an amateur night every Thursday where anyone could perform. Sign up was at 7 in the evening. The show started at 8. I asked how much it paid. She said it didn't pay anything. 29. Rise of the Bastard. What's your name gonna be, Kev? I was confused by my friend Raheem's question. I'd been trying out some jokes on him, my roommate Paul, Zachary, and Spank in the car to warm up for amateur night at Laugh House. But they were barely laughing, and when they did, it seemed to be out of politeness. I was starting to have some serious doubts. What do you mean? I asked for clarification. Your comedy name. Everybody got a comedy name, you got Cedric the Entertainer, Earthquake, Sinbad. So what's yours? I don't know. You mean to tell me you'll be thinking up all these jokes and you haven't thought of a name for yourself? I guess so. The Bastard. What? Yeah, your name should be The Bastard. Why? 'Cause your dad ain't never around. Unlike my jokes, Raheem's got a laugh. Maybe he knew what he was talking about. Y'all think that name's funny? I asked. That's funny as hell, Paul said. When people hear that, they'll go crazy. Raheem turned down the stereo, then announced, Philly, make some noise for Lil Kev the Bastard. And crank the volume. Everyone in the car started hooping. All right, if y'all say it's funny, I'mma go with that. In retrospect, I wish I'd put a little more thought into it. A stage name is like a relationship, easy to get into, but hard to get out of. In the days that followed, I tested out jokes on my coworkers and customers. I practiced every night on my roommate. Everything became a joke or a potential joke. If I burnt food I was cooking, I'd say, yo, I just burnt the food. I got food burn. I shoulda put suntan lotion on. Paul would smile politely, and I'd ask, that was a funny joke, right? You think that's a funny joke? My pocket was full of paper scraps with joke ideas I'd written on them. If I ran into a friend, I'd pull out a scrap and say, tell me if you think this is funny. Fortunately, my friends continued to encourage me. Paul, I don't think that's funny, man. Spank, that ain't gonna work, Kev. Zachary, you sure you wanna do this, man? Even Kenneth, hey, you're my little brother and I love you. So whatever you do, I'm gonna back you. But I don't know, man. I just don't think this is your thing. When the day of the show came around, I had so much nervous energy, I couldn't sell a thing at work. All my friends thought I was fun to hang out with. But none of them seemed to like my material. My other worry was that each amateur was allowed only 5 minutes to perform. The night before, however, I practiced in the mirror and timed my routine to 7 minutes and some change. And I couldn't get it any shorter. Please don't let this go badly, I kept praying. Please, God, let me be funny. That's all I ask for. I was so inexperienced, I worried that if I sucked, people would throw tomatoes at me. That's actually what I thought happened at comedy clubs. It never occurred to me to go to the Laugh House or check out another comedy show. First, some friends were planning to drop by only to see me fail, so they could fuck with me about it later. My brother was coming with his buddies, dudes who knew me when I was 4 years old. They were all expecting to watch something horrific. Of course, they had every right to set the bar low. The last and only time I'd been on stage before was at my swim team's graduation banquet. If this were a musical talent show, I could play some shitty song and everyone would politely clap afterward. They could even yell and scream like I was a star. But this was comedy, and laughter can't be faked. I would know instantly whether I really was funny, like Alice and Michelle said, or whether I was a joke, like my friends thought. My enemy that night would be silence. I had to do everything in my power to get that room going, to shine on stage or die trying, and most importantly, to prove my friends and brother wrong. Sometimes other people's doubt can be the best motivation there is to succeed. Life lessons from passion. Putting all your eggs in one basket will lead to the birth of chickens that you will have to eat. What I'm trying to say by this is, love what you do, which of course means What are we talking about again? This writing stuff is tough sometimes. Just read the section.